In this video, we're going to talk about arc length. So arc length is the measure of the length of a segment of a function. So if we have some generic function that sort of looks like this, and we want to measure how long it is from a point A to over here, a point B. Well, we have an intuitive idea of how long this segment is, right? And we could approximate it maybe by doing a straight line segment, and we know that it squiggles a little bit, so we could be a little better than that, maybe doing a couple of straight line segments. And that's exactly the principle that we use, and we're going to formalize that with calculus techniques. The idea is that we're going to break up this line into lots of little segments, n different segments, right? And if I look at one segment individually, and I want to find the length of this one segment in here, I'm going to approximate it by a straight line. I'll write it here. Here's my straight line. So a straight line connecting those two points, and I'll call the length of that L. And because it's a straight line, I'm going to make this L is actually a little triangular region, right? The length of this line segment L is the hypotenuse of the triangle with base given by delta x and height given by delta y. So I just broke this line segment up into a lot of little pieces, and then looking at one little segment, I see that the length L, if I connect it as a straight line between the two endpoints here, the length is going to be given by Pythagorean theorem. So let's write Pythagorean theorem over here. So that means that L squared is going to be equal to delta x squared plus delta y squared. And I can rewrite that as L being equal to the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared. And notice that L isn't the entire length, right? L is just this one little line segment. And so sometimes we call it like L sub I, because I'm just looking at the ith segment, one of the segments within many of them. But how big are each of these pieces, right? And this is where calculus magic happens. So, maybe not magic, but I'm okay with a delta x. If I think about taking the limit and these delta x's getting smaller and smaller and smaller, I could see how that could become my dx, my differential for the final integral. But what about this delta y? I don't like having both x's and y's at the same time. So I ask myself, where have I seen delta x's and delta y's in relationship with one another? And really, delta x divided by delta y, well, we can think of this as slope, right? Our approximate slope is given by the change in y over the change in x. That's how we measure slope. And as our delta x gets smaller and smaller, we know from Calc 1, that was a big concept, that change in y over change in x, our slope is given by the derivative of our function. So if I can perform some algebraic operations and I see that by multiplying delta x by both sides, delta y is about equal to my derivative function, the slope function, times delta x. And I use this to substitute into my L function to get a better function. So here's my scratch work for calculus magic. And let's continue on with our formula for L sub I. So L sub I, we see, is equal to the square root of delta x squared plus delta y squared. And we just decided that delta y squared can be replaced with f prime of x delta x. And the nice thing here is that now I have everything written in terms of x's. I've gotten rid of the y's and I have this as a function of x's. Technically speaking, which x am I using here? I'm using the x that was in the ith segment. So for notation, we usually put a little x sub I here to indicate that we're in the ith segment, because different segments, we would have different f derivative values, right? Depending upon which segment we're in. I can do some factoring. So this is equal to the square root of, notice that there's a, maybe I'll write out one more step. This is delta x squared plus f prime of x sub I squared times delta x squared. So there's a delta x squared term in each of these that I can factor out. It still stays under the radical, but this becomes delta x squared times, well, this is really just a 1 plus f prime of x sub I quantity squared. And the cool thing now is that the square root of delta x squared just becomes delta x. And I get a formula of the square root of 1 plus the derivative at x sub I squared times delta x. That's the length. And maybe I should have approximates for each of these. As soon as we plugged in this, it becomes approximately equal. Right? It's our estimation of the length here using our derivative function at delta x. But that's just one length, right? So this is the length of the ith segment. But we want all of the segments, right? We want L sub 1, L sub 2, L sub 3, all of them as you go along. And so the total arc length is going to be given by the sum of all of the segments as I goes from 1 to n of each of the segments, each of these L sub i's, right? This is just saying that I'm adding up each of these L's, these line segments. And I want to look at the limit of this sum as n goes to infinity, right? I want to break these intervals up into smaller and smaller pieces. I want to get more and more and more pieces because this limit will actually yield the exact value. And the exact value, the limit of this sum, is going to be the integral. In this case, my starting point was x equals a to x equals b, the starting and stopping point of my length. This sum becomes the integral, and L sub I, we have a formula for what L sub I is. It's going to be the square root of 1 plus f prime of x squared, and this delta x, when I take the limit, becomes dx. So this is my arc length. One comment about this formula, something that's easy to mess up. There are two things here that I think are important. One is that you have to take the derivative first and then square it. Order of operations makes a difference here. Taking a function and squaring it and then taking its derivative is not the same thing as taking the derivative first. So you have to work inside to outside. Another thing that's tempting that a lot of people do is say, oh, it's the square root. I can take a square root of each of the terms, right? Like the square written all messy like this. But you can't do that. And I'll emphasize that again when we end up doing our computations. So let's go ahead and look at an example. Now that we have a formula, so let's look at an example of finding the length of one bump of the sine curve. So that would be from x equals to 0 to x equals pi. Recall that the sine curve starts at 0, 0, goes like this, it dips back down pi. So my function in this case, f of x, is equal to the sine of x. So recall from our formula, arc length is given by the equation from starting point to ending point in terms of x, in this case, is from 0 to pi. And it's the square root of 1 plus the derivative of your function squared
dx.
So we have to do a little scratch work. In this case, we have the fact that f of x is equal to sine of x. And so that means that the derivative f prime of x is equal to the cosine of x. Notice that I'm taking the derivative first, and then the derivative squared is equal to cosine squared of x. So we're ready to compute the integral. This is the integral from 0 to pi of the square root of 1 plus cosine squared x dx. And right off the top of our heads, this looks pretty nice, right? We know that from trig identities, 1 minus cosine squared is sine squared. But that's not what we have. We have 1 plus cosine squared. And even if we try to factor something out or rearrange the terms or multiply by a number, it turns out that there's no closed form. For this integral. There's no way that we can solve this by hand. There's no substitution or rearrangement or algebraic manipulation that we can do. So instead, we're actually going to have to do some sort of numerical approximation. And because it's more accurate, I'm going to go ahead and use Simpsons Rule, S6. So I'm going to take this whole interval and I'm going to break it up into 6 segments. So the total length is pi. That means each segment is pi over 6. And then 2 pi over 6 is pi over 3. 3 pi over 6 is pi over 2. 4 pi over 6 is 2 pi over 3. And then 5 pi over 6 before we get to pi. And remember that Simpson's rule is, it's sort of that average of three things. It's delta x divided by 3, and then it follows that 1, 4, 2, 4, 2, 4, 1 pattern. So instead of writing this whole expression out each time, this is the function that I'm integrating, right? I'm not actually integrating the sine function, because I'm trying to compute this integral, and this is something that can be sort of confusing, because this was my original function that I'm finding the arc length of, but in my Simpsons approximation, I want to include this function as my function. So to do that, instead of calling it f, I'm going to call it function g, because it's different than our original function f. So I'm going to do our first endpoint once, g of 0, plus 4 g of pi over 6, plus 2 g of pi over 3, plus 4 g of pi over 2, plus 2 g of 2 pi over 3, plus 4 g of 5 pi over 6, plus just one copy of the endpoint g of pi. And I'm going to make this note that in this case, g of x was the interior of this integral, because that's the piece that we're trying to approximate. And I also want to note that delta x in this case was equal to my total length divided by 6. So that means that S6, to spare you the details of seeing all of that, I actually did this on my calculator ahead of time. Pi over 6 divided by 3 is actually pi over 18. And g of 0 is 1.41. And I should include more decimal points, 1.414. Plus 5.292 plus 2.236 plus 4 g of pi over 2. Pi over 2, in this case, that's 0, so that's just 1, so that becomes 4. That's the one I can do in my head. 2.236 is 2 times g of 2 pi over 3, plus 4 times g of 5 pi over 6 is 5.292 again, and then g of pi is 1.414. And if you type that all into your calculator, you find out that the Simpsons approximation yields something similar to 3.82. 2. So this is a nice application where I can use Simpsons Rule to be able to calculate this integral that we weren't able to compute by hand. A second approach, and maybe the approach that I find maybe a little more comfortable, is that we were trying to find the arc length of f of x, which is equal to the sine of x from x equals 0 to pi, x equals pi. And GeoGebra has a nice feature to be able to compute this. Clearly you can't use GeoGebra on an exam, but in any real life application it's nice to be able to do this. And the function in GeoGebra, you can just type in length, and then you can type in the function. In this case, we set the function equal to f, and then the starting point and the ending point in terms of x. And that delivered a result of 3.8202. Another option in GeoGebra is to input the integral that we wanted to compute, right? Because we're finding the arc length of this function, but we found that that arc length is given by an integral, the integral from 0 to pi of the square root of 1 plus cosine squared x dx. And I can compute this integral using the integral command. We had the command integral of, we would have to type in this this function, the inner function. In this case, we would say g of x is equal to the square root of 1 plus cosine. In GeoGebra, you have to write cosine of x squared, right? That this is this function. So we're taking the integral of g from 0 to pi. And that's finding the area under this curve from 0 to pi, which is what computes the arc length. And thankfully, it gives the same result, 3.8202. So two ways that we can compute arc length in GeoGebra: directly using the length command, or indirectly by computing the area under this integral curve.